Since 1887, the Stonington Free Library has been a center for knowledge, ideas, creativity, and entertainment. It is a comfortable and welcoming community space for the town of Stonington, Connecticut, where all ages can explore, discover, gather, and learn within a building of distinctive and unique architecture. This video program is an evolution to expand the offerings of the library to share directly in your home or organization. Welcome to the Sunday evening lecture series made available to you by the Stonington Free Library.
He's been now for 3 years the curator in charge of the Metropolitan Museum of Art's medieval collections and the Cloisters. It's important to note that the Cloisters is part of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So without any further ado, I'll introduce my wonderful husband.
Thank you very much, Amanda. It's really nice to be introduced by your spouse. And also thanks very much to all of you for coming out this afternoon. It's such a beautiful day out there, but it's so nice to see so many friendly faces in the crowd. Before I get started, just a quick story. Amanda and I just had our 25th college reunion. And this morning, we all have name tags, of course. This morning I picked up the name tag and I walked down through the breakfast line. And it wasn't until I got to the very end of the breakfast line, I'd been chatting with lots of people, that I realized my name tag actually was Amanda Mann. So it's nice to like figure out, okay, I'm Griff, you're Amanda, we're... So without further ado, as Amanda said, this is a talk that's really designed to set up this visit to the Cloisters on Tuesday, but I also approached it as a standalone. So if you're not going down to the Cloisters, this is still something that will, you know, I hope be informative and engaging. And the way that I've decided to frame it is I'm not assuming any knowledge of the Cloisters, really, or any knowledge of medieval art. So the talk really is designed to fall into three distinct sections. The first is just a basic overview, a kind of quick history of the Cloisters, how it is that this special place came to be where it is, and at what moment it was created, and how the collections themselves were assembled. The second part is a kind of quick highlights of the Cloisters, just so you can get a flavor for some of the kinds of objects that you might encounter there. And then I'm going to take a more detailed look at about 6 individual works of art that are a mixture of, you know, kind of generally agreed great masterworks or things that I find particularly interesting. And the reason that I chose those works of art is because they each in their own way demonstrate some general characteristics or features that are common in the artwork that was produced in the European Middle Ages. And so hopefully by the end of the lecture you'll have a sense not only of the Cloisters, but some of the themes that you might find that resonate with works of art produced in this moment. So first, to take a step back, and just a kind of broad overview, where is it, you know, how did it get to be there? The Cloisters, as Amanda mentioned, is in the very northernmost tip of Manhattan. And you're looking south now towards the lower island, lower part of the island. On the right, up at the very corner, is the George Washington Bridge. And the Cloisters is in Fort Tryon Park, which was created as a park at the same time that the Cloisters itself came together as a building. And that's something that we'll get to in a moment. So what is it? How did it come to be? You know, who are the characters that were involved? Well, think about the northern end of Manhattan in the early 20th century. This is a shot that gives you a sense of what that landscape looked like. You can see the palisades across the way, still very actively being quarried for the kinds of stones that were used to as cobblestones on city streets. And then here in the foreground, you can see the ridgeline that encompasses much of what's now Fort Tryon Park. There were a few private estates up that way. There was also an inn at a time when motor cars, horseless carriages, were just coming into use. People would take these day trips out of the city and they would go to this inn that was a little bit to the right of that photograph. John D. Rockefeller Jr. would actually ride his horse up that way and became very familiar with the landscape and developed a real affinity for this part of Manhattan in an era prior to its development. You can begin to see some apartment buildings down there along what's Broadway, just at the lower end of the frame here. So two people that are central to understanding how the Cloisters came to be. One on the left, as a young man at about the age he would have been when that photograph was taken, is John D. Rockefeller Jr. That gentleman on the right is a man named George Gray Barnard, who is a sculptor and also a dealer and collector. And his primary medium was stone. He was a sculptor who worked in marble. And he had a major commission for the State House of Philadelphia, in Pennsylvania rather, in Harrisburg. And one of the ways in which he wanted to create the more ambitious version of this commission that he wanted to produce that required extra funds is to begin buying and selling works of medieval art that were available on the market in Europe. So by 1914, he had assembled a significant collection of sculpture. He was selling some of it to places like Philadelphia. Institutions like the MFA Boston were buying from George Gray Barnard. But he also kept a huge amount and created a private museum. When he shipped all of the material he'd assembled in 1914, just before the outbreak of the First World War, to New York. And he created at this site that I'll show you in a moment, highlighted, a museum that he himself called the Cloisters. No affiliation to the Met whatsoever at that point. Imagine something that's sort of like a brick barn with a timber roof like the one that we're looking at today. And he actually displayed inside this building examples of medieval art, complete with candlelight and guards that would wear cowls so that they would appear monk-like as they walked around inside the space. So a very romantic vision of what the Middle Ages was all about. But his concept was also that American artists and artisans would be inspired by this work, by looking at the work of their medieval predecessors who were crafting objects out of things like marble, limestone, wood. So think of that space, the Cloisters, operating as this kind of quirky place on the upper end of Manhattan. Negotiations begin with the Metropolitan Museum of Art in the early 1920s. And by 1925, John D. Rockefeller Jr. decides to purchase the Barnard collection. And so at that point, he purchases the collection, the buildings, and gives them as a gift to the Metropolitan Museum of Art to run as its first branch museum devoted to the art and architecture of the Middle Ages. So basically, the Met started to operate the building. But to that core building, they added an herb garden. So that concept of a collection accompanied by a set of gardens was something that was right there from the very beginning when the Cloisters was created. So one of the things that John D. Rockefeller Jr. wrote into this gift agreement was that at some future date, he would preserve the right to relocate the collection to a new custom-built museum that would be designed to house the things that Barnard had purchased. And so many people tend to think when they come to the Cloisters, it's a building that's kind of been lifted up piece by piece, brought to the United States and rebuilt on that site. It does incorporate actual elements of medieval buildings, but it's a concept that's informed by medieval architecture. The building itself is modern and it does incorporate medieval elements along the lines of a monastic space. So you have this cloistered interior, which is lined by the capitals and columns that you can see in a covered walkway around all sides. It's that concept of a cloister that really lies at the root of, say, university architecture, where you have a college campus designed around a series of quads. That's something that really comes right out of the Middle Ages. So
John D. Rockefeller Jr., I mean, think of it.
This is taken in the 1936. The Cloisters opens in 1938. So imagine the height of the Great Depression, undertaking this project to create this museum that was built to house the Barnard collections, to kind of resituate them. There was a tremendous amount of work being done by the curator and the architect, Collins, the same architect that worked on Riverside Church, this kind of wonderful neo-Gothic structure a little bit more to the south. They traveled all over Europe together, and the models that they looked at very much informed the concept of the building that they eventually would create. So here you can see examples of monastic architecture taken from, in this case, both of these churches I'm showing on the left in detail are from the Pyrenees, but in the French part of the Pyrenees. And you can just see how the architecture and these kind of volumes and shapes really informed Collins and the curators that were involved in this project. So by the time we get to 1938, the Cloisters is opening to the public for the first time, and it coincides with the gift, also at that same moment, of the park, Fort Tryon Park, to the city of New York. So Rockefeller funded both of these initiatives. He began buying up the land that would become where the Cloisters is now located, but much more than the 4 acres on which the Cloisters is anchored is that surrounding parkland, and it's an Olmsted design, so it really captures the views and vistas that are so powerful as you sweep out across the Hudson River and look over at the Palisades. And when you come from this direction, this photograph is taken probably from the highest natural point on the island of Manhattan. And those of you that'll come on Tuesday are going to eat in the New Leaf Cafe, which is situated also in this park, not just a little bit to the right of where the photographer was positioned when he took this photograph. On a day like today, when the news is so grim, I thought that I would actually read from John D. Rockefeller Jr.'s statement when this building first opened in May of 1938. So he said, when the Cloisters opened, if those who come under the influence of this place go out to face life with new courage and restored faith because of the peace, the calm, the loveliness they have found there, if the many who thirst for beauty and are refreshed and gladdened as they drink deeply from this well, those who have builded here will not have built in vain. It really is a kind of oasis in a crazy, crazy world in a busy, busy city. And I think one of the things that makes it so special is the combination of great works of art, this fantastic setting, that sense of being transported into a different place. It's hard for us, I think, in an age when travel is so easy, to imagine a time in the 1930s when a trip to Europe was a steamship trip for most people, if they were going at all. So think of the idea that really informs the Cloisters of, rather than hanging medieval art in a modern setting, to hang it in a setting that's sympathetic to the art and architecture of the time and the places that it came from. The idea was to create this sense of a European kind of foothold right there in Manhattan itself, so people who would never have the opportunity, perhaps, to stand in a building that felt older than something colonial would have the chance to have that kind of experience. So when you come to the Cloisters, most people who arrive, most people who come by subway. The A train goes right up to the base of Fort Tryon Park. It's a really nice walk this time of year through the Heather Gardens. But the other thing that we have that's really, really rare in New York is free parking. So if you drive, you can park generally right across the street. This is the entrance that you come in. We're just going to, do a quick walk now through the building. The Kusha Cloister, which is the core cloister at the heart of the museum, is the one that's pictured here. You have 4 lady apple trees anchoring the 4 quadrants. And it's planted according to a modern kind of decorative garden concept. So the idea isn't that all the plants in there are the kinds of plants that would have been used for different purposes in medieval Europe, but rather this is the garden that's designed to be beautiful over the course of the growing season. Downstairs, there is a garden that's planted according to medieval horticultural information. So it's lovely, different times of year. It's especially nice now because those walkways are open to the gardens, and there's this sense of moving in and out of gallery spaces, inside, outside. You have this wonderful fragrance that wafts through the galleries from the fresh flowers that are growing. very different in concept is this cloister, Saint-Guillaume. This is actually an enclosed space rather than a garden space. But it has these fantastic capitals that were carved in the 12th century in an area of France that's at the very south, also in the Pyrenees, that's along a pilgrimage road, the main pilgrimage route that went from northern Europe down to Santiago de Compostela in Spain. This is called the chapter house. So this is where monks would meet for their daily meetings. There are actually benches, stone benches, that go all the way around the edge of this room. When this was purchased, this is actually one significant piece of architecture that was purchased during the 1930s. As the museum was working towards opening this building, this became available on the market as a structure. It was being used as a stable when it was sold. And it's one thing that's kind of a core part of the physical fabric of the building that wasn't a George Gray Barnard acquisition. So when you're at the cloisters, if you're looking at our labels, the accession numbers, which is just a fancy way of saying an inventory number for a work of art, anything 1925, that's a George Gray Barnard acquisition. Anything after that was purchased with funds that Rockefeller gave to enhance the collections. Favorite recent acquisition is very modest. This is actually a bell. And it's a refectory bell, so we keep it sort of near the chapter house. I don't think that the sound will come through, but one of the things that I was really excited about was actually getting to ring the bell, which our visitors don't get to do, but we did make recordings so you can hear what it sounds like. It's got a fantastic timbre, but even better is the inscription, which says, "I ring for breakfast, drinks, and dinner." Cloisters has a wonderful collection of stained glass, and what makes it so exceptional is not just the quality and the range of what you see on view, but also the fact that almost all of the glass in the collection is actually backlit by natural light, so it's designed, you know, it's being presented in the way that it was designed to be seen. In most museum collections, you have light boxes that are used to present something like this. So there's this very powerful interaction at times between the sun, the light streaming through into the galleries, the stained glass that's being illuminated, and then the play of colored light that you can find on the floor of the gallery and on the works of art. So you get that sense of the kind of multimedia nature of what medieval art is really about. I mean, medieval art isn't something that, you know, sits in a square on a wall necessarily. It's often about an immersive environment, an environment that might encompass architecture, glass, metalwork, sculpture, all in one space. A highlight certainly for any visitor, especially this time of year, is the gardens. I mentioned upstairs that the garden is primarily ornamental. Downstairs, where you have these great panoramic views south and west over the park and across the Hudson towards the GW Bridge and the Palisades, is the Bonifant herb garden that's laid out each bed according to a different theme. We have one that's devoted to ritual and magic. We have one that's devoted to medieval crafts, medicine, medieval households. So you really get a sense of the relationship, the close nature of the relationship that existed in medieval art and life with the natural world. And people are especially now, I think, have come to love these grand quince trees. These are very venerable quinces, each of them about 70 years old. We've started actually some younger quince trees in the orchards down below this wall, waiting their turn to rotate in as these get to the end of their lifespan. Downstairs, there are two sets of galleries right off of these gardens. One is called the Treasury, and it's in the Treasury that some of the great objects that really are most important to see up close with good lighting are on view. What's astounding, though, and this gives you some sense of the generosity of John D. Rockefeller Jr., is that after that core Barnard acquisition, he provided an endowment to the museum that would allow for the continual development of the collection. So everything that's on view in the Treasury is post-Barnard. That gives you some sense of the nature of the objects that the museum began to acquire and the kinds of things that were on the market. I showed you the bell. That was something that we purchased just 2 years ago now. And in fact, we're going to be at auction tomorrow, so fingers crossed. Some wonderfully surprising things. I mean, this is an example of an ivory, so you can recognize the form of the tusk that this was carved from. But so imagine this is one solid block, a cross section through a large elephant tusk, probably in this case African elephant ivory rather than Indian. And it was made in the context of the Islamic courts of Spain.
So this is something that was carved during the reign of someone whose dates we know, 912 to 961, so 10th century. Look at the detail, the level of undercutting, and the way that you have this very, the composition of the animals facing each other, that kind of symmetry, is something that's very characteristic of Umayyad luxury objects that were highly coveted, highly prized objects in the context of Western Christendom. So things like this ended up in church treasuries. This was originally a perfume container, but once it is collected and absorbed into a Christian context, it begins to be used as something like a reliquary, an object made to hold venerated remains of saints. The cloister's cross, ivory also as a medium. In this case, however, this comes from northern England, and this is walrus ivory, an incredibly complicated program. This was made for a monastery where there was a highly literate audience, and you have scores of Latin inscriptions with a very anti-Semitic program actually behind them. This was a moment in and around the area of Bury St. Edmunds, where this cross was probably made, where there was a tremendous amount of conflict with the local Jewish population, and eventually the Jews were expelled from England. So this is a real kind of glimpse into that moment in time. Metalwork, objects, in this case it looks like a solid piece of gold and silver, but in fact the carcass, at the heart of this object, is a piece of wood. It's a wooden core carved to look like a human arm and hand extended, and then encased in this kind of golden skin and the costume, the details of the costume with the folds of the garment. This is the kind of thing that would have been used to hold a relic, a venerated remain of a saint. And on an important feast day, the bishop might have brought something like this out and actually used it to bless the congregation. So medieval objects were often meant to be used. They were functional first and foremost, even though we now recognize them for aesthetic objects. Private devotion, these little tiny precious things, are also significant number of objects that are on view at the cloisters, would have been designed not for large audiences, not the kind of big public statements that you expect of something like stained glass or mural paintings, but rather something that you would sit down with and spend time with. This is about the size of a book that you can easily cradle in the palms of both hands. It's a wonderfully sumptuous object. Holding an ivory diptych like this feels a little bit like holding a cold bar of Hershey's chocolate in your hand just before it begins to melt on the warmth of your skin. There's this wonderful tactile sense to it. Look at the level of the undercutting in that ivory. Again, two cross sections, vertical cross sections through a single tusk, joined at the middle by a hinge so that this could close up and you could easily carry it with you. The subject that's being depicted is the Last Judgment, that moment at the end of time, according to Christian belief, that Christ will judge and separate the good from the bad. So you have on the right-hand side, Mary and John the Baptist actually kneeling, acting as intercessors on behalf of humanity, asking Christ for mercy. And then you have the angels waking up the dead with their trumpets. And those that are already on their way down into the sinister realm are being swallowed by that beast on the right with his open mouth. Those that are on their way to a different place are climbing that ladder on the left up into the heavenly realm where Christ is sitting with Mary being crowned. It's not all, however, about religion. This is one of the things that I think is hard sometimes with medieval art. There are so many sculptures of Madonnas and Childs and important narratives that come out of the Bible that are featured in stained glass programs, but there was a tremendous interest in a secular world, the world of the everyday. Something as simple as this, this would have been a very highly prized object because rock crystal, which forms the heart of this vessel, isn't something that the people in the West had the technology to carve until the 13th century, when in places like Paris and Venice, they rediscovered how to carve rock crystal. The Romans knew how to do it, and then it's a tradition that went into the Islamic world, and people like the Fatimids in what's now Egypt perfected it, and it was highly, highly coveted by Western Europeans because it was this kind of miraculous material. People didn't know how they did these carvings, By the 13th century in Paris, they begin to figure it out. And rock crystal in the Middle Ages is a material that people believed was magical. It had, I mean, people today associate certain properties with things like rock crystal. This is a wonderful object, not just because it has that special glass at its core, but this too has an inscription, which says actually around the base, "He who drinks from me shall ever happy be." This is a very special wine glass with a lidded top. That's why it has a hinge on the left there. A personal favorite for me is also, in this case, ivory. This is a mirror back. So imagine cutting a cross section now through the tusk, preserving the round shape of the outside of the object itself. When you're looking at this, it looks like a siege, right? You have people who are outside wearing armor trying to get in. The portcullis has been lifted and these people are sallying forth on horses. If you look carefully, up at the very top, there's a figure who's defending the castle. He has a bow and arrow. He also has wings. That's Cupid. And it's Cupid's arrows that are actually inciting the knights outside the castle to attack because they're trying to get into their ladies' chambers. Those are all women defending the castle. And they're pouring flowers down on their attackers out of that basket. So rather than rocks and hot oil, you have rose petals. And then you have this character on the left with the crossbow. He's actually got a flower in rather than an arrow in his bow. So this is really something that comes close to the themes of chivalric love and courtly culture from the end of the first part of the 14th century in Paris. This is something that was probably carved around 1320 or 1340. These are very, very hard to find now on the market because they're highly prized and coveted. But this was acquired relatively recently. This was actually acquired in 1983. So a closer look. So we did a kind of overview of the history of the cloisters, a look at the kinds of objects you might encounter in the galleries. And then, as I said, this is more of a selective sampling and a little bit of a chance to look in depth at a group of objects. So I've chosen different kinds of things, architecture, paintings, sculpture, and tried to vary the geography a little bit too. So. One of those things that makes the cloisters a special place in the main part of the year, say from October up through May, is that we have musical performances in this space, which is named after Fontedueña, which is the place that the apse comes from in Spain, in Segovia. So you can see it here filled up with an audience that's watching these singers perform. One of the things that's amazing about this space is that it was really made, designed specifically for the human voice. So when you stand in the heart of the apse and you project your voice out in this direction that we're looking, sort of, you know, imagine the sound coming towards you, that architecture behind you, that wonderful Romanesque architecture with these big solid masonry walls, really projects out and resonates with the human voice. Amplified music doesn't do nearly as well as the unaccompanied voice. So here's a closer look at the apse. I wanted to give you a sense of this particular object because this is an example of the kind of work that went into creating the cloisters. This was an apse that existed in a castle in Spain on the kind of borderlands between where the Islamic part of Spain was and where the Christian kingdoms to the north were. So think of it as a place where there's a tremendous amount of conflict and change over time. Lots of castles. This one, the apse itself was built probably between 1175 and 1200. And you can see here the difference between the masonry that's medieval and the masonry that's modern because it's a distinct change in color. You can look up at the ceiling, for instance, and it's a brighter white masonry than the more weathered stone of the medieval object. This was added to the cloisters in 1957. And in 1958, they finished the construction. You can get a sense of the details, fantastic string courses. I mean, this is a space that's very lively, although, you know, solid and strong in its architecture. It has these wonderful little details. All of it obviously hand-carved by trained masons who, some of them might have specialized in decorative work, like the coursework you're seeing, and others in figural decoration. Some of it places to really express the human imagination. Here's a figure being torn apart by two beasts, symbolizing the kind of the violence of the world around a culture like this. Wonderful example now of this same building from the outside. You get that sense of the solidity of the walls. The load-bearing weight is really being done by the walls at this stage rather than by the buttresses that might be introduced in the Gothic era. Here's a shot of the castle, present-day shot. This is a permanent loan to the Metropolitan Museum of Art by the Spanish government. And in exchange for the apse coming from this place, I'll show you a photograph of what it looked like. This is what it looked like before it was disassembled. There was a local church that was heavily used by the town that's near Fontedueña. That church was restored and a number of paintings were returned to the Prado from the Met. So part of this arrangement is what lies behind how you can take, you know, part of a building. You know, issues of cultural patrimony are really important things now. And imagine, though, that you have to number each one of these blocks, right? So that you're disassembling it piece by piece. The reason that the architecture had dropped away from other parts of the structure is because the best stone was reserved for the apse. So that most important part of the building received the best materials, and then there were lesser materials used for the walls, and those had fallen away. This is, you're seeing it now being used as a cemetery. Here it is in context. And those of you that might have made the trip down to New York in 2013 would recognize this shot, the 40-part motet. This is a piece of contemporary sound art by a Canadian artist whose name is Janet Cardiff. And we presented it at the Cloisters in 2013. It's called the 40-part motet because there are 40 voices in this early 16th century piece of music by Thomas Tallis. And each one of those speakers represents one of those voices. So as you came into this space, you would hear this kind of surge of sound. The piece would play. Janet Cardiff kept recording during the interstitial space where the singers were just conversing or clearing their throats. So it's a, you know, it's an example of it felt like you were almost standing in and amongst the singers and the choir. The reason I show it is because programs like this are really important, I think, for helping us rethink permanent collections. And I had an opportunity to think in a very different way about the sculpture that I'm showing you here, to a large extent because of the experience of being in that space and listening to this sound installation. One of the things I'd never noticed before is I'm showing you now a detail of the lintel up there. These characters who are lined up in this procession have their mouths open. A few of them, I mean, the sculptor really had to work to create that. I mean, when you look closely, they've really deeply undercut the mouths, and there's this kind of dark space that opens up. And I thought to myself, I don't know if I've ever really seen sound depicted so explicitly in medieval art. And I went back to look at paintings and other sculptures from about the same period. So the subject of this is Christ's entry into Jerusalem. So this is the beginning of Holy Week, when Christ comes in to celebrate Passover with his disciples. Here's that same subject, in this case roughly the same date, about 1170. And there's definitely things happening. People are interacting with each other, but generally when medieval artists want to imply exchanges, spoken words, something like that, they'll use hands. They'll use hand gestures. They don't open mouths like that. So I thought, it'd be worth kind of taking a closer look at this painting, I mean this sculpture. So turns out that this door was added to that space not long after it first opened. So the Fontedueña Chapel, we've looked at the architecture of that area. This door was carved in 1170 in what's now Tuscany, not far from Pisa. So it comes from a town called Massa, which is highlighted by the arrow right up there. When this stone lintel and the portal itself was carved, it was part of a small church dedicated to someone called San Leonardo. And the church was along the pilgrimage route that linked Rome to Transalpine Europe. But because it was so close to Pisa, it was also a major site for people embarking on journeys to the Holy Land. Think of the Crusades, for instance, a moment when many, many armed Western Europeans are getting on boats out of places like Genoa, Marseille, and Pisa, and they're sailing to what's now Istanbul, Constantinople, they're sailing to places in Syria, Jordan, Egypt. There's also a tremendous amount of trade that's happening at this time. San Gimignano is a town in Tuscany that some of you might know. It's famous for its saffron. And the saffron that was grown in the hills around San Gimignano was actually being shipped out of Pisa to places in what's now modern-day Syria and Israel. So this is the context within which the door is produced. But I'm also interested in how objects actually get to the museum. So how do you have a single doorway ending up in a place like the Cloisters when it starts its life attached to a church building not far outside of Pisa? Well, turns out that this door is something that two individuals are especially connected to. Thomas Hoving on the left was the first curator of medieval art for the Cloisters, and he went on to become director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art. He worked for a man whose name was James Rorimer, famous as one of the monuments men. Rorimer was the director, Hoving was the curator, and Hoving would go on frequent trips, acquisition trips to Europe. And on one of his trips, he found out about a story that is connected to the countess who I'm showing you on the right. She owned a villa not so far outside of Nice, and she wrote at the end of the 1900s, about 1893, she writes to Italian authorities to notify them that she thinks she has the portal to this church in Massa that's been built into her estate. Italian authorities, for whatever reason, don't take any action. And Hoving learns about this when he is in Florence, not so far away, finalizing the acquisition of this object, which is an Annunciation from about the same date, but produced for a church in Florence. Hoving writes to a colleague and says, I've heard about this doorway. Can you please go to Nice and have a look? Colleague goes to Nice, and he writes back, there is no doorway. The estate itself is actually gone, and in its place there's a high-rise building. Hoving writes back saying, can't just have disappeared. Something like that has to be around somewhere. Sends his colleague back, and his colleague sends back this photograph. Turns out it's still there, but it's in a field. It's been disassembled. You can see the lintel there with the vertical elements, the posts on either side. And Hoving writes back, very excited. His colleague says, actually, it's not that good. I don't even know if it's marble, so it might not be worth your time. So Hoving kind of stops for a moment. But then he decides to make a trip there. And he comes back to look at it, and he discovers that not only is it marble, but it's actually a pretty strong sculpture. But he feels like the lintel is the best part of it. And he says, he writes this telegraph to Rorimer, and he says in it, the lintel is in good enough condition and is sufficiently important, both artistically and historically, to carry with it, like a landslide election, the lesser members of the ticket. So it lifts up the two supporting elements, and anyway, it ends up coming into the collection. So what I found really interesting about reading through this file is that when the work of art entered the museum's collection, there were actually two missing heads. Now there's just one. So how did that happen? Well, it turns out 1961, this work is acquired by the Cloisters. 1962, Hoving returns to this area outside of Nice and finds the second head in a beauty parlor shop. So here's where it needs to go. There it is before it's reunited with its body. And there it is connected to the body that it belonged to. But when you're at the Cloisters, if you look carefully at these figures, you'll see that they're not, most of the heads are a uniform color except for this one head that's had a different history, obviously, than the rest of the group. So who knows, maybe there's still one more head to collect out there. So for those of you that travel in that part of Europe and you go in for a haircut, please keep your eyes peeled. So Pisa. One thing, so works of art come into the collection in different ways. They often have very interesting stories behind them. Pisa is a place where the presence of Roman antiquity is very visible. This is an artist who worked in a context where you actually have Roman inscriptions, Roman stones being reused in medieval buildings. It's much easier to harvest stone that's already cut than it is to quarry it freshly. So he's looking at Roman art and architecture, and it's no surprise that his lintel looks very much like an early Christian sarcophagus. In fact, this artist, whose name was Beduinus, signed an actual Roman sarcophagus. A medieval artist looks at this Roman stridulated sarcophagus and signs his own name to it. It turns out that those vertical elements that are now parts either half of this doorway are actually two halves of a Roman sarcophagus that he cut down the middle, carved the outsides, and reused. So you can see the shape of the sarcophagus. You can imagine reassembling something like this. Wonderful example of medieval storytelling, the Archangel Gabriel hovering in the air, that messenger that moves between heaven and earth, isn't touching earth. The wings are extended beyond the frame of the picture plane. Mary, the human in this interaction, is engaged firmly, 2 feet planted on the ground, and she is contained by the frame. So artists will use things like scale or abstraction exaggerations to communicate their stories. So I'm going to jump ahead, just in the interest of time, to one work of art that I don't want you to miss. And I'll finish with this story of the unicorn tapestries. So this is really a high point of any visit to the Cloisters. You know, if there's a group of objects that the Cloisters is probably most famous for, it's the unicorn tapestries. So we've been looking at early medieval art. In the tapestries, we're looking at works of art that were produced around the year 1500. A totally different world in terms of art making. This is the rise of commercial artists. Artists are beginning to sign their works, so the identity of the concept of the modern artist as we know it is just nascent and beginning to emerge at this point. The kind of iconic image here is the unicorn in captivity. But this is a set of tapestries, and they tell a story. So how do we understand these? Well, one way to understand it is to put together the different episodes and the narrative that the tapestries unfold. Imagine a set like this might have taken 15 years to make. 15 years to make a group of objects, group of works of art, as much time as, you know, great buildings. So this is a story that begins with a group of hunters setting out into the forest. Their quarry isn't yet clear to us. There's no sign here as to what they're hunting. But in the very corner, there's a man who's calling to them. He's deep in the woods already, but he has found the trail. So he signals to his companions, and you sense them talking amongst themselves as they gear up to enter the woods. These woods, however, are a special place. They are enchanted. Things happen in these woods that don't happen in the real world. Things like an orange tree down at the lower right part of the composition that has its oranges but also its blossoms. That doesn't happen in the natural world. The blossoms come before the fruit. So this is a special place that they have found. And in it they discover the unicorn. The unicorn dipping his horn into the waters, surrounded by the huntsmen. It's the unicorn that's the quarry. The unicorn here is not only bringing the animals of the forest together that would otherwise be enemies, so peace reigns, but also purifying the waters. You just have to think, like, medieval people, did they really believe in unicorns and think that horns like this could hold powers? Well, imagine rhinoceros today. That horn and its powder collected for magical, for sexual potency and things like that. So, in any case, the unicorn itself is the quarry, and by the time you begin looking at the details, you're really taken in colored thread. How can you achieve that sense of water splashing on the surface of a still pond and a bird looking at his own reflection? I mean, that is amazing. And then the hunt begins. Now, the unicorn is unconquerable, generally speaking. So this is something that the hunters don't enter into lightly. They release their dogs, they're trying to stop the unicorn from getting away. So the hunt really begins in this sense, and it's the visual language is that of a stag hunt. So the artist is really drawing from real experience and imagery. To give you some sense of the colors that have changed, I'm actually showing you an image that you'd never see at the cloisters. This is the back of that same scene. The colors are much more vivid because there's been less exposure to light over time. But imagine how vivid these colors were in the originals, looking at that whole scene brought to life in that way. Here, the unicorn is in a fight for its life. But the hunters would discover that the unicorn is too powerful to capture, so they have to resort to tradition, which is you send a virgin out into the forest, and to that maiden only will the unicorn surrender himself. So here in this fragmentary part of the cycle, you actually see the unicorn with this woman in red, but the woman in red is an accomplice. The main actor is the maiden, only her right hand survives. You can just see it coming around the back of the unicorn's mane. Her fingers are right here. So she seizes the moment and she signals to the hunter who's waiting in the forest. He blows the horn, the dogs have already jumped the fence. Here, just to give you a sense of what that moment looks like in an ivory box, you've got the maiden and the huntsman coming in to deal that final blow. So how do we understand something like this? Well, one thing is clear is that these were definitely designed as a set because they all have the same letters in them, A and E, this monogram. So it's possible that that monogram might be connected to a patron, the person who commissioned and brought these objects into the world. But the subject itself, how do we understand it? Today, we still don't understand exactly how to interpret these tapestries. But I'm going to read you one poem, and I'll end with this, that might give you some insight into the frame that you can use, which is courtly love. The unicorn was often an allegory of courtship and of the lover giving himself up to his beloved. So here is a poem from the 13th century. The unicorn and I are one. He also pauses in amaze before some maiden's magic gaze, and while he wonders, is undone. On some dear breast he slumbers deep, and treason slays him in that sleep. Just so have ended my life's days, so love my lady, lay me low. My heart will not survive this blow. So perhaps it's that blow that's being dealt to the unicorn in the upper left, where the spear pierces the unicorn's chest. And then the unicorn reemerges in this enclosed garden, tied to this tree by that chain, but content, content where he is. And when you look closely, that red that you see on the unicorn's back is not blood, it's the fresh juice of the pomegranate that's dripping from the tree above. And many of the flowers that have been identified in these tapestries connect to themes of love and fertility. So it's that sense of the human world, of love, courtship, that perhaps is the best one to understand the unicorn tapestries. So I realize that I went a little longer than I anticipated, but I want to thank you all very much for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions if people have them. Thank you. We all might want to get outside too, so there don't. Yes?
We get a feeling from your wonderful talk that perhaps 800, 900 years ago, people were more civilized than we are now.
Yeah, I think they were more civilized than we give them credit for. But it was also a very violent time, and I don't know, I feel like it might not be so different. And I mean, in some ways, it's a connection, right? I mean, things that were happening then are still informing very important issues in our world. There's actually an exhibition that will mount opening in September in the main building of the museum, which is devoted to the topic of Jerusalem in the Middle Ages, from the year 1000 to the year 1400. And many of the themes of conflict that resonate in today's
part of the world there were similar issues to what, you know, people in the Middle Ages were really grappling with. So on the one hand, I think there is a sensibility that's different, but on the other hand, sometimes I feel like we're not so far away from where we were then. Yes? Right. So the Met in general is actually very thorough in any new acquisition. So I think there's a different set of standards that we use now, perhaps, than was used a generation or two generations ago when the Cloisters was created, for instance. Cultural patrimony issues are less of a lightning rod for this kind of material than they are for antiquities, where the issues are often illegal excavations and a whole black market that's really fueled by objects like this, and there's a lot of evidence now that contemporary terrorist groups are really beginning to use antiquities also as assets to build resources, to buy arms and things like that. In fact, ivory as well is something that's implicated in those kinds of activities. But we do very thorough reviews. If anyone comes forward, you know, one of the ongoing issues is Nazi-era provenance. The ownership history of works of art between 1933 and 1945. If people can come with information that helps us understand where works of art were during that time period, we generally open an inquiry. So we try to be as engaged and responsive as we can be when those issues come up. Yes?
You didn't speak anything to a painting.
I didn't. In fact, I skipped over one group of paintings that I would have spoken about. The Cloisters, in fact, there's a strange distinction at the Met. Many paintings made in the Middle Ages, in what we would call the Middle Ages, are upstairs in the European paintings galleries. So although there are a few very significant paintings that are part of the Cloisters collections, the strength tends to be more objects, textiles, and things like stained glass. But if I can, since you asked, one of the great paintings in the collection, let me just go, is the Merode altarpiece. And just bear with me while I get up there. Here it is. This is one of the real landmarks of European painting. It's the advent of oil painting. And it's produced around the year 1430. And it's the oil medium that allows that wonderful purity of color and the translucency of some of the objects that you see. One of the other things is how vividly real this picture is for contemporary beholders. We tend to think of something like this as an old master painting, but I'm just going to go back here. Imagine that when that painting that I just showed you, the Merode altarpiece, was made, this is the way most paintings looked. Gold ground being used, that sense of otherworldly, the purity of colors. This is tempera rather than oil. Imagine going from that to this in the same generation. That is cutting edge contemporary art to those eyes, right? I mean, that's something that you really haven't seen anywhere else that seems to emerge out of nowhere. In fact, it probably comes out of manuscript illumination, these kinds of paintings. But this is a wonderful example of an artist really looking very carefully at the world around him. The Archangel Gabriel here stands in front of a table. The candle has just gone out as Gabriel has entered the room, kind of divine wind that blows out the candle. But the message here is also that the Old Testament is being extinguished, and it's the beginning of a new story. That ceramic vessel, there are vessels in our collection that look just like that. So imagine looking into a painting of a historical narrative taken from the Gospels and seeing in it a world that's recognizably an extension of your own. That's the beginning of a real modern paradigm right there. You know, the frame serving as a window that looks through into a world that's connected rather than to something that's very different. So there's one really great painting at the Cloisters, and then there are several very good ones. Any other questions? Yes?
The uniform. So the uniform you thought was killed when the arrow spikes it, and then it lives.
Well, it is killed when the spear strikes its heart, and there is another interpretation of that story that, and it comes out of medieval texts, that the unicorn is an allegory for Christ. So it's a Christian allegory, and so there is a reading of those tapestries that I'm not as strong a proponent of, that reads it as a Christian story. And the A and the E in that case are interpreted as Adam and Eve. And the unicorn in captivity is back in Eden. Eden is kind of restored. Well, I can sense that people would now definitely like to be outside. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks again, Griff. You're a great friend.